makes it. So I'll stick to the 18 minutes that the organizers have given. So what are the possibilities? What's next? Let me start off by trying to be a storyteller. I'm going to pretend though. It was way back, long ago, not so long ago, in the 50s, that a bunch of scholars and scientists put together, proposed that, you know, machines can actually start learning, reasoning, and behaving and acting much like men, much like humans. And they called it, and they gave the term, artificial intelligence. And what has happened after that was a lot of seesawing. And IBM, for instance, in the year 2011, demonstrated what could be the peak of human-machine interaction in a very natural and in a very human-like manner by playing the game Jeopardy and winning it against the then reigning champion. And in more recent times, less than a decade, we had MIT's Kevin Ashton, who turned around and gave us this lovely word, this phrase, the Internet of Things, or IoT, as is on the lips of almost every engineering student, and almost it's permeating and going beyond the realm of technology into social life, affecting both life and work, impacting rather, not affecting. And so, here as a speaker from IBM, I would like to tell you that IBM, even before 2008, had already been talking about insightful decision making that is being driven from the intelligence that is born of the instrumented world, which was highly connected. But what is the crux of all of cognitive and the Internet of Things? What is the crux of the physical and the digital? It is the human experience. Wasn't there a time when you as a client was just taken for granted when you went to a shop to do some shopping? Today, are you being taken for granted? If you are taken for granted, what would you do? You would walk away and take your business to somewhere else. And so that human experience, be it in work life or be it in social life, is at the heart of what cognitive can bring to us. And so, sometimes back, what sounded like a glib talk, marketing hype, and a lot of hyperbole, today is just an understatement. We have moved from fad to facts, and absolutely grounded here, it has arrived. The Internet of Things has arrived. These numbers that you would see up here, the value of business crossing about, touching almost $2 trillion by the next couple of years, or the number of devices that stand connected, the projections going up to almost 30 billion, and the fact that the vast majority, more than 80%, of people who are managing these in businesses are beginning to adopt it and no longer just sort of keeping it on the periphery but trying to get immersed into it. This is the reality of today. The previous chart had some estimates which have been already revised by analysts. The projections are that by 2020, these numbers would go perhaps past the 50 billion mark. Now, just try to understand what is a billion and these kind of, and how much of that is already connected as of today. And that is the huge opportunity. We are talking about less than a percent And from there to where we are headed at the speed at which we are proceeding, it is indeed a humongous task. And so, what are business leaders really, really trying to do when they have their existing businesses and having to cater to a whole new ethos and a culture and an expectation from clients? Primarily in three areas. The first is to try to improve the operational efficiencies. None of you ever went and stood in a queue, filled out those little forms which needed an extra lens, even if you had the best of eyesight, to book a railway ticket. None of you here, at least the students, have gone and stood in a queue and picked up a cinema ticket. You all go bang, bang, bang. When the class gets a bit boring, your thumbs are twiddling away, and there you're done. Almost you've done the Zomatos, you've picked up your burgers, you've ordered your burgers, and a whole lot of things happening. But look at the operational efficiency that has come through from then to now. You are a generation that was born on the cloud, and therefore you may find it difficult to understand what it was like, but folks in the front row here definitely are able to see the big shift, and that is one area. And what does it result in? Goes back to my earlier point of the human experience, in this case, in the context of business, the customer experience. And finally, what ends up happening is there's a whole new way of doing things. It's almost a rip and a replace sort of a situation. What happened to the friendly taxi guy that your granddad and later on your dad and your aunties and uncles were using, where they would just go from the first floor and shout and he would come, or the rickshaw guy at the end of the road? And now, what has happened? Where has Uber taken us? What happened to those friendly taxi guys, the cab guys who had a fleet of 10 or 12 cars? Where are they gone today? What's happening? It's ripped up, a very simple example, but just start scaling it up. And so this is the immediate opportunity, and the value is a given. There's no going back on that. The point is, even though we are 10 years, almost 10 years since we coined these phrases and have started moving on and starting to see so much of change, it's still the beginning. It's still the initial stages. The sad part is, it's like this guy who's in the middle of the ocean and dying of thirst because there's no drinking water. So here is an ocean of data. But businesses are struggling. Businesses are wanting that extra edge and they're not able to get it. And that's simply because of the fact that we're not able to see it there. It is there, it's hidden, but we're not able to get to it. Of all the data that is even available today, just about 10 or 12% is what is being used, and the rest is all wasted. This is a fact of life. And this is what you're going to see shrinking as time moves along. And that is the generation that you students are going to be entering into and starting to contribute to with your problem solving, with your technical skills and your capabilities. A monumental challenge, yes. If you look at it from the point of view of what was being done almost for half its lifetime, the IT industry was all about programmable systems, programming the system, the computer. But when we take a shift and we start looking at solving this monumental task and we move into a whole new realm, a paradigm shift in the way we approach it, and we look at cognitive systems, cognitive computing, then it becomes addressable and easily so. So here there isn't an element of predictiveness. You don't ask what is the answer, but you are more like asking what are the possibilities. And that's what comes through from these systems. So it's only with cognitive that we can keep up, be it work or be it life, with all this kind of rapid change and humongous amount of data that is being generated. There are four basic stuff, pillars, if you like, of cognitive, which you would easily relate to. To get the machine to interact with us humans in the natural language. And this is not just about text-to-speech or speech-to-text conversions, which you must have covered in your formal curriculums. But this goes beyond. It goes about intent, it goes about tone, it goes about sentiment, which is all part of the natural language that we speak one to the other. And the machine learning. How are people to know, how are systems to understand the sentiment behind it? When there is a mechanic that goes on the field and when he starts collecting his data and starts maintaining his logs, also a call center generates a humongous amount of data in a day, in a shift. So all of that, blogs that you write, tweets that you put out there, if you look at, this is what we are producing as content producers, and in the realm of what is known to the realm of what is not known, and that's the insightful part, which is what cognitive and IoT brings to us. We at IBM have been already working at this. A couple of numbers, and Rahul, my good friend, has already left, but when he put up that chart on don't sell, just tell, I hope you don't feel I'm selling here now. But this is like to tell you that we are very serious about it. Look at the number of patents. The number of patents are over 700. The number of clients actually is slightly dated, that should be more like 6,000. 20 industries in 25 countries, actually revised upwards to 30 and 30 as I'm talking to you. And the industry's first dedicated cognitive business. That's the kind of effort that IBM has already put into this. And please note, this is not about I, me, myself, my puppy and my granddad. This is about collaborating. This is about working with. So, it's about the partners. It's about all those old legacy kind of businesses. If you have an elevator company like Pony, what is he doing? He's in the business of taking people up and down in life, or escalating them up and down in life. That's it, right? But what has he got here? What about Tiger Woods swinging away his golf club? What about cycling? We'll come to that in a moment. But the fact is that no matter what domain it is, at work or outside in social life, we need people to come, and therefore IBM has taken this wonderful step and invested a very large amount of time, effort and money, and we just inaugurated this IoT headquarters in Munich, which is the automobile hub, if you like, the heartbeat of the world. And so there you are. Look at the number of developers who will be coming into this place with over 1,000, is able to make sense of this and able to leverage the sensory world of IoT and cognitive. Take someone like an engine manufacturer who was just, his core competency was just doing engines. Cummins. Now all of a sudden, he's gotten into software and he's using simple technology to get feedback from all of his engines that are running out there to do a host of things, including improving the future releases of his engines from all of that data. Take Daimler, a car manufacturer of repute. What would he do? He has actually gotten into something completely different because there was a compelling business case. right? I could go on till the cows come home, but I think I've got the 80-minute limit, and therefore, you need to understand that irrespective of who the end user is in the medical field, I've not left out your principals and college professors, they're on the chart as well, okay? Everyone that you can think of, these are all, you would relate in your own way to one or more of these words that you find on this chart. A cluttered one, no doubt. But lawyers, policemen, cyclists, golfers is not up there on the chart. Farmers, fashion designers, to have all of these ways in which you can walk around with a dress that, you know, tells the sentiment of a particular event that you want to be, you know, parading and advertising. So there is, each of these are traditional. None of these words are just born yesterday or day before yesterday. But they have to be disruptors. They have to reinvent themselves and the way they do things. If the cops are still going to be going around the way they were going around, you and I better watch out. So, to wrap up, the big difference, even if I keep showing you a couple of more videos, at the end of the day, the machine was anyway invented by man. And so it's only up to that point. It's all about augmenting the human capacity, the human intelligence, the human efficiencies, the human thinking. It's only augmenting it. It is not equal to or replacing it. So we need to work. The human element is important, and that is the element of skills. And since you are predominantly an audience of students who are in your undergraduation, I think this is something that you need to really sit down and think about. What is the kind of skill that I need to have? Getting to know the technology behind each of these, be it cognitive or be it IoT, is something that is a given. But what is really required is to be able to get that ability to engage with systems, and that's a notch above and going beyond technology in a safe, in a secure, and in a very effective manner. And that's what all of those businesses that we saw just now are looking forward when they come and look at yourselves as fresh talents to be acquired. So this is the world that you are stepping into. And I'd like to say that we have a GOT that is born of IBM's cognitive platform Watson, and IoT is the genius of things. And guess who is the genius of things? Is it the machine or is it you? It's the human. So that's exactly what we need to do. And I'd like to conclude quoting the chairperson, president and CEO of IBM, Ginni Rometty, who said, "This era will redefine the relationship between man and machine." And that is just what you are stepping into. So all the best, and thank you very much for having me here.